working on career opportunities, how has the Methodist Fellowship provide career for the youths? Like, in a particular diocese, you know that after your university, you are expecting a job, and you can't, and because of the way the economy is right now, the way Nigeria is, like Nigeria, where Nigeria is, there are no jobs available for fresh graduates. So how has the Methodist Church Youth Fellowship, how has it helped in that area?
Oh, well, I think that for those who have capacity to help, they have been trying. And I must say honestly that those who actually are willing to help don't have the capacity to help. Those who are willing to help don't have the capacity to help. But those who have the capacity, well, let's say they are not willing to help. It could be as a result of certain things that they have seen, certain things that they have witnessed. I'm not giving excuses on their behalf, but I think that those who have capacity in Methodist Church in Nigeria are not willing to help. But that's the truth. Because you see, let me use my I came to Ibadan to work, and then I was offered 20,000 as a lawyer. But then I explained, especially in the Methodist, and I explained that, sir, I will have to travel for meetings, be national president. So, in fact, my first meeting at the Connectional Council of Evangelism and Discipleship, I completed it before I got there. Because it was a Saturday, my boss asked me to resume in the office first before I could travel to Lagos. I left, a colleague gave me a job and allowed me to travel. Today, I got to work and I told him, I'm going to Ibadan because I had a program. He said, oh, you're free to go. I saw it on your Facebook timeline. And he allowed me to travel. But, you know, these are people who are willing to help. There are people who are willing to help, but they don't have that capacity. There are a lot of persons that the church has helped, but there are a lot more that have actually not gotten the help needed from church. There was a brother I was speaking to, and he was telling me that he's moving to, I think, Daystar. One popular brother in Lagos, and he's moving to Daystar. Why are you moving to that? He said, because that was where he got the job. I'm saying, if that was that, I spoke with, he happens to be my uncle, so I spoke with him like that. So, he's a knight of the university. So I need a job in the FIRS. And he said that I should keep praying, but there are no jobs. And then the person I was seated with in the same office in Oshogbo got a job at NDIC. One of his northerner friends got NDIC and FIRS. At the same time, my own uncle introduced myself to as national president, said there are no jobs. So, for how long will we keep in this, when your friends keep getting the job and then you working so much for the church and then they keep telling you that there are no jobs and you can, we all started small. So you can start with the 10,000 job. Culture. Exactly what you get. So,
Thinking about that, culture is actually nice.
So, for how long do we keep somebody who went to school and took it and you are saying you should go to for agriculture? What is the duty of a Yoruba? You know, these are questions that you ask. And then you'll be like, oh, you can't even pay through your nose for these jobs. So, what I would advise, like I have started myself, is build yourself, build capacity. Eventually, the church will come knocking at your doors. Don't trust anything, but ensure that you build yourself to that point where the church will come knocking at your door. Because that is what we need to do. They are shutting doors against us, but we'll open for generations coming after us. We must ensure that we do that. The basic point of Methodist Youth Fellowship, sincerely, going through the bylaw, is to build capacity. If you go through our bylaw, it's to ensure that we build the necessary capacity. Academically, entrepreneur-wise, career-wise, look at marital life, you have to build capacity, your spiritual capability. So let's ensure that this period, what we do as youth is to build our capacity. Even though the jobs are not forthcoming, make sure you are doing something. Make sure you start something. You don't know how big it will go. That's why I encourage people when they tell me that, oh, I'm into this. In fact, I had to tell one of my presidents that if you need any legal advice or anything, call me. I'll be available for free for you. Because I think that is how we can help one another. As much as I'm advising him for free, I'm helping myself grow. Because if I have to write the prospectus, I'll write that I advise so and so. So, what can you do to help the youth beside you to grow and become better in life? I think that's what we need to do. Because if you keep working jobs, they are not giving us jobs, this and that. But what can we do to assist everybody around us? It is 10 naira that you have, give it to the person, to help the person. If that you have 10 naira, the person will not be able to afford 10 naira. So let's look at how, for career opportunities, let's look at how we can help ourselves. Oh, you are in NDIC and you know there is an opening. Can you bring in somebody? You are in the private sector and there is an opening. Can you bring in somebody? So let's keep opening up the connections like that. That is what will help us. But we cannot be talking about the problem. We have to be the solution ourselves.
Okay. Thank you so much. Career opportunities.
You're taking it from where the president left off, where we say we have to be the solution ourselves. I think it's a really difficult thing to talk about as far as Methodist Church is concerned, from my own perspective, from my own diocese, from my own circuit and local church. I see that in the past years, the church helps, the learning help here, making people advance in their studies and every other thing. I'm not going to mention names, of course, but I know about 2-3 persons that we grew together. The church stated they are studying, but they don't reckon with the church anymore now. So at that, you can't really blame the church as you got that anymore. Because you see that you learn helping out for you that you think they are the future of the church, and then when they have what they have now, they leave the church. They don't, even when you call them for programs to come from one to another, they don't recommend the church. So another thing is that individually, I think some people are trying. Just like the president has said, that those that are willing does not have the capacity, and those that have the capacity at times are not willing. I could remember someone also in the church, an elder, when he was a director of an institution, he facilitated the employment of some members of the church in that. So he did his best according to his capacity. So there are individuals that are really trying, maybe in groups or individually, they are trying. But how can they create that platform for career opportunities for the youth, for talent, for skills? They are doing a lot of that. So why can't Methodist Church also do that? Why can't we create platform for skills? Those skills sell faster now. At least you can start from there, then you grow to whatever you want to become. So that we need to actually talk more on it as regards the church with the elders. And also when it comes to help, I could only say it is, as far as I've been to, and I know in the youth department, they still have married, young married couples that are still within the good connection with youth. I've seen that most people, as far as they are actually doing great, they don't try to connect with them back. They don't really have enthusiasm to come back and connect. So how will they even help if it's when there is the connection that those you see as young men that graduated from the youth to get there, that you think they can mentor and drag people along? But if they are disconnected, then who? Because we are saying that we need to be the solution now. Then if we also grow out from this position, will we be able to also lend a helping hand to the youth coming on board? So because they did that to us, it's something I cannot forget. It's something some people might not forget. Will you be able also to carry people along, or will you also disconnect yourself? So it's what we need to continually talk about within ourselves and also with the church.
Okay, I have something.
Okay, I hear you.
I just want to add to goes and as an advice to the youth that dress for the kind of job you want to have, not for the kind of job you're doing presently. Develop yourself just as a national president said, because it is when you have the capacity, it is when you have what it takes to be in a position. So if you don't have what it takes to this position, you will not be considered. So don't look at what is happening presently. Find the church is trying, but yet they've not satisfied all of us. But that does not mean that we should start looking down on ourselves. We are unique youth, and we are people with fresh minds. So develop yourself and dress yourself not just in terms of clothing, in terms of your intellect, everything. Dress yourself for what you expect and not just what you are presently.
Okay. Very quickly, I remember the story of the wife of the priest, Mama Numa Uche, shared at the consular conference. And you know, we have to build capacity to the point that become free. Don't stop, let us stop hiding ourselves. You know, and she shared that she met this particular lady singing in a particular at a particular forum, and then she was trying to just relate to that. She discovered that she left Methodist. Ah, no, you have to come back. This is a talent that cannot just go away. So we have to build ourselves to that point where we become visible. Build, like, this is the 21st century. There are platforms for you to be visible. So build that visibility. Don't just hide under you are somewhere and then you expect somebody to come and drag you out. Drag yourself out. Because when you have built that visibility, you become an asset to the church. And then the church will do everything to ensure that you stay. But when you are just behind and then the church is not even feeling your impact, you cannot keep saying that the church is not doing anything when there is no impact felt. But if you are visible and then your impact is felt, you become an asset to the church and the church will not toy with you. So I think we have to build that visibility, just like she said. You dress for the judgment. You build that capacity and visibility for what you want to be.
Thank you. So what can we say on those? Okay, you mentioned something that there are some people like church have helped that do not come back to the church, even though the church helps them. And there are some people that the church has helped to add. Blem says that, okay, fine, this member of the church gets a job for this particular youth. And he gets there and misbehaves. That will not make the to want to do it for another person.
Yes.
So what can you say about that? It's, yeah. And again, that particular situation is actually rampant because there are a lot of stories I've heard that this person got a job for this person, I guess they got their misbehavior, maybe the person embezzled funds and stuff like that. It will not give the member, like, it's not making him want to do more for youth. Like, let me divert my attention to him.
I quite agree, and like I said when I first made my comment on career goals, I remember saying that people who have capacity are not willing because of certain dispositions that they have. Some of these people have actually seen the worst, and then we must tell ourselves the truth. Some youths are ingrate, some youths are not grateful, and you know that how do I put this now? First impression lasts long. So when a youth is offered an employment and then he misbehaves and then he is seen in the group of all other youths, what impression comes to the person that actually helped? That they are all birds of the same feather. So you have to look around this, and then we have to actually have the good character, the right character that will make our helper be willing to help us. But that's the truth. People are angry, people are leaving the church even when the church has helped them. They are not helping those of us who want to stay, and we are looking for help. They are not helping us. So what I would advise is, if anybody is helped as a youth, are helped by any member of the church or the church herself, you should be grateful and become an asset to help the church in whatever capacity you can, and not be an hindrance and affect generations coming after you. Because it's not just you, it's about people coming after you.
So I would like to add to that, in the sense that as for if I'm an elderly person trying to help one of the youth, I'm going to look at how deep rooted the youth is in the church. And how do you look at that? You look at this zeal. Has this person been in a position of leadership? Has it actually been active in the church? Because as much as possible, as we are trying to maybe integrate the youth, that the people that are in that active, we are trying to approach them with privileges so that they can be active. We should also not neglect those that are active, because when you neglect those that are active, also you already know those that are active, you know their capacity, you know what they can do to some extent. So those are the people that I feel you can actually give help, and you know you will be have this piece of mind that to a reasonable extent they represent you well. They are actually people that are actually deep rooted in the church. There are also youth that came to the church for help, and I see that they got the help that they wanted and they left. So we need to, as elders, I think they need to also think about that factor. Those that are active and actually have the church and are actually deep rooted in the church and the practice of Methodism.
Okay, thank you. From what you said, that's where responsibilities come in. You don't necessarily have to be a leader in the church because everyone cannot be leaders. Like in each tenure, I think you have just how many leaders?
Eight
out of the old youths in that particular church. But you can take up responsibilities. Like, this person gets to church early and arranges to change. Even if you feel like nobody is seeing you do that, there's one particular person that is wanting to see you that, this person is always leading the place, this person is always in the drama group, ready to work, ready to do this. You don't necessarily have to take up that leadership role for you to be seen doing those things. Okay?
Sorry, presenter, I want to appeal to our parents and our elder ones who have been, let me not say victims now, of such situations, that please keep spreading your seeds, keep sowing. You don't need to, because of one person, stop what you are doing. You never can tell. You can actually help someone that will make everything you've done and be remembered. So please, I'm pleading with us. Let's not just look at our youth and say, because it did not yield a positive result, then I'm going to stop. Please, you can still do more. Thank you.
Thank you so much. What is the particular, is there an age that an individual should leave the youth fellowship and become an adult, like start attending adult church, praying or this? I think he mentioned something like at the age of 30. And he still said it to attend. So in some churches.
Well, before I became president, that was a very, very hot issue in the area that I don't like to actually delve into because it's generally not a issue. But I think by the Methodist Church Nigeria system, there's a way they have actually planned everything. From the age of 1 to 12, you are still in the children department. From the age of 13 to 30, you are in the youth fellowship. And then from 13 to 30, you are in the youth fellowship. Then from 31 to 45, now it's young men, then from 45 and above, men's fellowship. That we can talk about that for the male, the female line now. 0 to 12, children department, 13 to 30, youth fellowship, and then.
As always, yes.
And then we begin to, then young men, then to women's fellowship. So I think the church has a structure already on ground for us to actually, we have the various platforms that we have on ground that will help us. But basically, what we do in youth fellowship is once you are married and you are 30, you join that young women. And then for those of us who are not married and we are still above 30, some of us have to stay back in the youth fellowship. In fact, I have one brother in my own local church. And if you tell him, go to the young men, no, I'm in youth fellowship because I have not decided to join. But whichever platform you belong to, make sure that you are relevant and then you offer whatever you can offer for the growth of the church.
Thank you.
Sorry, I want to say something about what you just said now, because I've noticed that so many of our young ladies are floating in church, especially when then you keep floating. So when they call young women's fellowship meeting, you look at yourself.
Is there even something like young women's fellowship?
Yes, there's young women's fellowship now. And be outside that, you also look at yourself as if, well, I am still a youth. If you are in such situation, look for a place where you find peace.
Mm-hmm.
Join where you find peace. I cannot be married. You know, tell me to now join young women. What are they doing there? What should I know that I want to go and do there? So, what I just want to say is, please, just find a place. Find a place that gives you peace.
Yes.
If you know that youth fellowship is the one that offers you the kind of peace you want, and it makes you stand in the church, it makes you do your normal duties, and you still love God. Remain in the youth fellowship. It is young women. Yes, you are a young woman because you are married. So please, you can definitely go. And for those who are not yet married and have attained the age of 30, such people, especially for ladies too, you feel like now they say it is young women and not yet a woman. So please, you need to find a place where you find peace and join where you find your peace.
Mm-hmm. I think we should just leave it at each individual's discretion. That's because continue to talk about it and it's still up controversy. It's better to continue to how you are led
Thanks for that. So moving on to the last area of development, the area of mentorship. In the Methodist Youth Fellowship, do we have like, okay, you know, mentors are like people you look up to. Are there people you look up to in the church, like your mentors in the church? And you know, if you have mentors in the church, it will give you the sense of, ah, this person is a great person. I have to level up, become even better than that person that you're looking up to. And it also gives you the sense that, ah, I should also have someone that is looking up to me. At every point, we always have someone looking up to us. My person might come to my mentor, ah, you're my mentor or something. But we always have someone. So in that area of mentorship, how has the youth fellowship helped?
Well, I feel that's a very, very big point that we must strive to feel in our generation. Well, I lost a mentor. So I born with nobody to my mentor. I met him and then it clicked like that. And when he died, I cried because it was painful. There's a lot to learn from this man who had dedicated almost all his practices to the church and was doing a lot of cases for the church for free. He was involved in the 2005 Constitutional Review. He was chairman for the Constitutional Review 4. How have you been balancing legal practices, church work, and all these things? But then I know that Wesley Chapel, Lekki, has that structure for their youth fellowship. They have this mentorship structure. I think almost every month they have a particular Sunday that is basically for mentorship. Almost every church can pick this up, and then all our elders should not just go without pointing out something to us. They've done a lot, they've seen a lot, and then they can help us better the church from their experience. So I think then I know that then Broshola, that's of the mentorship, right? Yes. That's what Jesha knows. Jesha, he has that structure for them. So I think basically we can do this, whether consciously or unconsciously. But I know we have the intentions that I have seen is all our former conference league presidents, most of them do not even have memoirs on church work. Our former priests don't get those things. You don't, you know, when you read books, you read from experience. I think you are unable to see how. And let's even ask ourselves then. How was the church able to weather the storm and then reunite when we united? There was crisis at the time, presidential, protracted, and all those things. How was it that the church was able to unite? And then when you think about it, you're able to look in the future and say, if something like this comes up again, this is how you can weather the storm. So, but all these things are lacking because we are not intentional about them. And if you don't learn from history, we are bound to repeat history.
Yeah.
So we have to just, whether consciously or unconsciously, but what our advice is, pick someone and then sit down with him and learn from him. My boss in the office, what I do is when they are less busy, at least I sit down with him. So, why did I ask him? You are this brilliant. Why did you settle for Oshogbo? And then he gave me the perspective. And I saw one of the big lawyers in Oshogbo now. It worked for him. So then I am able to say, okay, if he did it this way, I can add to that and then do it this way, and then it will work for me. So I think that is what mentorship can actually do. There are people who have gone beyond what I've seen, and then you're able to balance your things. Even when you are confused, you call on them. So I'm in between the devil and the blue sea. You know, there are bad options. They are able to help you weather and then even to help you see the good and the bad. So I think it will help us. But we have to be intentional.
Well, just like you said, it's very willing to feel. But I don't have mentors, but I have people I look up to in Methodist Church in Nigeria. One of is very Reverend Ajibuye at Madadanla Methodist Church. Mm-hmm. I see him as a tent maker. And yeah, we started from I was born in Ife, so I started at a Methodist Church in Ife. We started from More before they moved to Aladanla. And you can see that he has been supportive of the church.
Mm-hmm.
And whenever any reverend that is not agreeing with him comes on board, he knows this is his church. So he's just going to step back, let the reverend do whatever he wants to do. Eventually, the reverend is going to leave. Mm-hmm. Then he's going to handle his church. The youth fellowship of that local church has a sign of a support for them. So he has been supporting the church since I know him, even till now. So I look up to him. It's what I would like to do. Because I don't see myself being out of Methodist Church. Even though I might go out for a while to get some few things and then come back. But I don't see myself.
Are you saying you are leaving the church?
No, I'm not saying I'm leaving the church. But what I'm saying is I might just, in order to just learn a white form or that thing. But I don't see myself going
to church.
Of course, you can stay in church, but some fellowship to actually learn some other things. Fellowship, I'm not saying church, now we need fellowship. So, second on the list of my people I look up to is Sasi Obolade in Agbeni Katiga. I've seen him, he's always particular about the church activities, he's always about helping individuals in need and every other thing like that. And also, who I look up to, again, that I have not been able to grow to be very close to is Sachi Bodiakindele, who is the now. I actually wanted to approach him because I look for his, he has an autobiography, I did it Godfrey. So I look for it everywhere in the libraries. I even checked online Amazon, but I could not get. So I actually wrote to him and so that I could get a copy for me. Well, I was hoping he would reply to something, you know, is it dead album. So I see that it's something we need to talk about, mentorship. We don't have it at all. We don't at all. At any level, we don't have it. What I see is that even from the elders, it's like, okay, we started from this church, we've been in this church, let us finish in this church, let us continue to attend. Not that they are enthusiastic about it, it's just that it is what we need to do. Let's continue the legacy of our parents, and that's because for Agbeni Katiga as it is, most of the members come from far and wide. You see people that come from different angles of the town, very far places, from Oniya, from Express, a lot of places just to come on that Sunday. So they are just saying, let's populate this church, let's do what we can while we are still alive, and let's see what happens. So there's no zeal again for even the way I see it, for the elders, they're not saying, because if there is zeal, they want to mentor the youth to say, okay, you will be our future when we are gone, you will be the one being in this position. So why not let us use all our strength and everything we need to encourage youth and also mentor them to be a better version of us. So we need to work on it.
As people you are directing this to, I'm very sure they can hear us and they're taking notes of everything you said in the Methodist Church Nigeria and the Youth Fellowship. You have anything on mentorship?
Okay, let me say that I know that some people are trying. I can talk about my Diocese Fellowship. He's trying his best. Yoruba saying that Bose does that. Send your body and bala on a Latin, a man shaking your man near a dear. That is, on your way home, if you don't find people that you can actually look up to, it's become a bit difficult. And when it comes to mentorship is in different levels and different areas. Not just the spiritual. I have my mentor, and he mentors me on every side. But there are places where he's good at, and there are places where I have to also look out for someone else to assist me in that line. So don't just look at it as if mentorship should be just about the church. It circulates generally. It should be in all spheres of life. So as youth, we should actually look out for people we know that these people can assist us and they can correct us. I'm talking about constructive criticism now. People that can call you to order, people that can help you, and at the same time, just as my brothers have said, people you can discuss with. I once had a youth say, telling me sometimes back that he had a mentor, but the person does not know. He just mentors from afar like that. And when he has issues, he does not even have the privilege of meeting with the person to discuss. I was like, my brother, you have not entered into mentorship. Because you need to be able to sit with the person. It is not what you see, especially our ministers. What you see on the altar is not all about them. There is something behind the altar. So you need to meet with them, ask them, how do they go about things? Try as much as possible to learn. It is when you learn those nitty-gritty of those things that by the time you come out, you are able to stand. But I saw this man comes to the altar and he's on fire for God. So next time I'm coming to the church, by the time I come, you'll just be doing gymnastics. Yes, you'll just be doing gymnastics because you have actually not learned how to live in the how to study. And these are the things that this man has brought together that makes the man that is standing on the pulpit. So let's try as much as possible as you to move closely with your mentors, not just be looking at them. Move closer to them. Ensure you learn and learn rightly. If you notice that one area is lacking, look out for it because you want to compare to your mentor. So you cannot just settle for it. What else?
Amen. Thank you so much. So our time is fast spent. I have just one more question, and that's for you. Actually, it's just because you are the national president, and I feel you'll be in a better position to talk more about this. You know, okay, I think at the end of at the beginning of every year, there should be a plan for Methodist Church as for the youths. Is that so? Am I right?
I don't need to apply. Thank you very
much. Do you have any plan for the youth? Are there plans for the youth in Methodist Church?
There is actually a 5-year plan.
Okay.
That expires this year. Then we make another 5 years, 2021. But there is a 5-year plan. That's why I said I don't know the kind of plan you're talking about, because you know the church has a policy of developmental plan. It's always renewed in 5 years. They're able to do a lot of monitoring and evaluation to know whether what the ones you have been able to do, the ones you've not been able to do, and then you adjust, repeat, adjust, or introduce new ones.
Okay, that plan you just talked about, is the church, are they fulfilling the plans they put in place for you? As for everyone, as youths, and take it now, they are moving to Pentecostal, new generation churches. They are moving, they are like, they are not getting what they want. Again, Methodist Church is old fashioned, because no, we are kind of ancient and that old time. They think Methodist Church is old fashioned. So, what do you have to say on that?
I think I should face the camera.
Okay, yes.
No, basically, I think that one of the mistakes we are making as youths, saying that the Church of Peace. When you go to these churches and then you are very much involved in these things, you will know that basically they've adopted what we do, what we call order of service. It is in Yoruba language, are what these Pentecostal churches have adopted now. They sing hymns, they play songs, they do almost everything. So, what is the difference between the Pentecostal churches and Methodist churches now? But basically, what we need to look at is how do we become more relevant? How do we actually position the church to be the first century relevant? Now, it brings me to this particular event. This event is organized by a youth body in the Archdiocese of Ibadan, sponsored from their funds, not from the funds of a church. Whereas the church will start saying that the youth are not doing what they ought to do. You know, why late? Because one of the software we are supposed to use got expired, and one person from the media crew had to pay from his own account. So what else the church will take us serious? It now brings me down to my point. We are contributing our quota to the development of the church, and the church has to support us. It is not, I'm sorry I'm sounding this way, but it is no longer business as usual. If people are willing and they are sacrificing everything they have for the growth of the church and so that the church can be visible, I think at this point the church has to support them. COVID has happened and it has happened. What do we do moving forward? Support the ones that are actually putting the church platforms. This is possible today because this set of youths are able to bring in their resources, and I can reach out to everybody. I am personally committing my funds also after this event to this program so that it can continue. But the church cannot mean that they are not concerned, because that is what it is. That is amazingly what is happening. We are just having a Methodist TV on YouTube for the first time in 2020. So I think that because there are no platforms, but the platform existing and there, after they see that the church is supporting, they will come back to say, oh, let us join. I learned how to use the projector, how to project in church, in Methodist Church in Nigeria. And it's useful for me. In events when I go around, it's useful for me. But then, we are learning this at our own cost. The church should support. The church should support, and that is what can stop mass exodus of youth from the church. I think the point is clear.
Okay. Thank you so much for that. Should I ask you to give another closing remark?
I would have to give it.
Okay, thank you, because we've come to the end of today's program. I'm very sure you'll be able to learn a lot from Brother Abimbola, Tijesunimi, and Brother Kayode, because they've shed so much light on this issue of Methodist Youth Fellowship, a platform for opportunities. There are a lot of opportunities attached to the Methodist Youth Fellowship. Out there, youths that are still thinking of migrating, let me put it that way, migrating into other churches, we have a lot in store for you and you to begin to realize and see those things in Methodist Church. You have to open your inner eyes to see those things in Methodist Church and stop looking for it elsewhere, because we have them right here for you.